Hello and welcome to Lab Insider. My name is Max and I'm your host for another exciting episode. Imagine data being locked into one experiment and never to be seen again, stuck in an archive somewhere in a basement. Our job is to make sure that data is accessible to everyone. And there's one man whose fight it is to free the data and make it everyone's domain. We want to bring data back into your hands. Joining us is Felipe Albrecht. He's a senior scientist in lab automation at Roche. Welcome, Felipe.
Hello, Max. Thank you for inviting me.
Felipe, we've got a lot to cover today when it comes to data, because this is your field of expertise.
In the last years, I joined Roche, where my first place was working the mass spectrometry automation in the labs, where I faced the initial issues, where the data we generate the data, but was not well captured by our systems. In the sense the data was generated to answer the questions, and after the data was just a byproduct, they are archived mainly for IP protection, IP questions in the future, but it was not a common to think the data reuse in the future.
Right, it's kept in these, I'm not gonna call them silos, I'm gonna call them archives, dusty.
Exactly.
Yeah. Old dusty archives in the basement.
Exactly, where you say the data go for dying.
Where data goes for dying.
Yes, rather than you get the data and put that organized and use for, think where you can use this data in the future, we just put that. And it's all, people only remember how the data was bad organized when they need the data back, when they need to revisit the data, for example, to deeper analysis or revisit the analysis they did, the evaluation of the data. So, and it's always complicated for the lab scientists to do this, for colleagues in the labs, and was close to impossible for data scientists to use this data. Because no metadata connected or sparse information.
Basically, we have situations in which an experiment is carried out, and for whatever reason, we can go into these reasons in today's episode of Lab Insider, but basically, data is taken out once and then it can't be analyzed again.
It could be analyzed for the same person or the same lab, but because this person knows the situation where this data was generated, or he knows the system well, he knows where to find, but no, people move between jobs, people are promoted, people move, change their labs, and new questions come, other people want to look at this data again. And that becomes a problem because we didn't have we have the electronic notebooks, but was always a searching process, not just, let's say, a Google search, but a deep search. You have to look, open your file exploding windows, try to map the file names with the experiments. So right. We need a lot of work. It's really cumbersome, this process.
You have to essentially know what you're looking for.
Exactly. We cannot get out these data files. Let's be honest, we generate hundreds of data files each lab per week. And we cannot do a large scale exploratory of this data, or even, well, it's the biggest buzz and biggest fun part, the machine learning. We cannot ingest this data in a machine learning algorithm and after make a model for understand this data better. And that was not possible.
We want that for data.
Exactly. We want that for the same for our lab data. We want to, because sure, the companies have the intellectual property about the software. I'm never going to discuss that. But we must have the ownership of our data. We generate all these data files. Again, millions of euros invested in these data files to answer some biological, chemistry questions. But now if you decide as company not to work with this vendor anymore, and you don't have the license for the software anymore, we lost access to all this data.
And that's your experiment.
Yes, it's our data, but the vendor has the control about this. That's why one of my main work and goals today is to free our data.
The liberation of data.
Liberation of the data. So it's hard to, is a strategic view for a company to do this. Because for what we have to try and sell these points for our colleagues in the labs, They are very focused on their problems. That's very important. It's still the core of our business is what they do in the labs. What we are doing here is supporting them. But we have to make them to understand the long term about these data files, that we don't generate these data files now only thinking about this single problem, but the entire benefits this data can bring in the future. Again, machine learning, deep analysis, even simple tests and checking how is the instrument working over time. So we have all these other questions that we can answer with this data.
I always envision a world in which obviously all of our information is made available to be able to improve the workplace.
Exactly.
And that includes labs. But how close are we to actually having a feasible machine learning program if all the data is not yet available to us?
That's the main, because for machine learning, we need a lot amount of data and good quality of data. If you get files with not proper annotation, describe how this file, the content of this file, how it was generated, being more concrete in the lab, like the sample preparation, the instrument model, the parameters of the instrument, the configuration, and also the molecule. You don't have all these attributes that we call metadata.
Right.
Together with the data, we cannot use this data for machine learning, or can only use for very simple tasks. So, but I'm quite optimistic in this field now. I see there's a lot of change. It may be not only technological, but cultural change. In the sense that now it's come some open standards. I can see, can mention two, animal and allotrope. They are kind of competing standards. It's from different companies, from different groups of companies or people. But in my opinion, both are good. Depends what your problem is. And with any of them, you are freeing your data. So my suggestion when people ask me which format you have to pursue, I say, see the one that fits your need. And the goal is to free open your data. After you get from this blob that I said before to allotrope, animal, or even some XML or JSON files or text file, convert it from one to the other is much simple, because there you have the control of your data. So that's, I think, the first step to open, to remove this vendor locking about your data content.
How close do you think we are to reaching this, a general acceptance of free data?
Now I think the vendors have to move to the next step. Okay, now we are opening your data and what we can provide for you in the labs. You open, or they must also make a suggestion, they provide ways to open in the data. Because of this, we are opening a new door in the lab automation. We are talking about connectivity between instruments and platforms. For example, we can make a really complex data pipelines from the instruments to the analysis, where you can have a person, automatic, a person receive a mail, or lab scientist receive a mail, he review the analysis, make some points, submit, and go further.
And that calibrates the instruments.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And go, and the instrument can learn from this, the algorithm that do the analysis. So from the process that was very much the machine only give the data, and after you have to connect, now we can make a full end-to-end data pipeline in the labs when you have this data open. And also, I even go a bit further talking about the instruments itself. Now, animal and allotrope is for the data, but also talk with the instruments. We have to say, hey, instrument, declining the data from the sample. What's the status? We can talk with the instruments.
When you mean talking with the instruments, do you mean like a voice interaction, a verbal interaction?
No, not verbal. That's the next step also. You can do this. But because the main pain point now of the instruments is that vendors also change this. Many vendors also have APIs and communication. But the only way for you to check how the instrument is working is you go to the computer instrument, log in, and look in the software. But why you don't have a communication like a dashboard where you can check how all your instruments are right now?
Like a cyber physical systems.
Yes. Or how we can, sure, we still need a human interaction, we still need to put the samples, we still need to check how is the situation of the instrument. But why you don't have also in the future, looking forward the next 5-10 years, why you cannot have a robotic system that put the samples there? Automatic, after put the sample, it trigger the analysis. Or lab automation system collect the data, do the first processings. And after the scientist does the analysis, the final analysis.
Essentially, if technology were to progress, the primary ingredient, so to speak, should at least be free, so that
exactly.
they can focus on a business on a business unit that actually has some potential. Because
just here, free and not free of cost, but free in the sense of open.
Free, yeah, without the formatting hurdles.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You call in open source not free as beer, not give you a beer for free to you, but free that you have the full understanding how it's work. And if you want to change the process, you're allowed to do. So that's, I think, is a point. Sure, it's a much more complicated environment, actually, because pharma involve money, involve a lot of controlled environments. We cannot put in a GMP any software there. You need a lot of validation and this costs time and money.
That's
but
right.
if the software is validated and we know that this version, why cannot we use the same standard and even the same software tool in other parts? So rather than each new project we have in automation in the industry, in the company, you have to do again and again for different companies, why don't have already some pieces together that you can just reuse and make all this process much faster?
You mentioned one thing that very specific to the pharmaceutical industry, and this is pharmaceutical data principles, the FAIR principles.
FAIR is not pharmaceutical only, it's a data principles, but the FAIR principles, I think, is something very important, is that findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable data. We in pharma, especially, I can say at Roche, we are pushing a lot these principles, the FAIR principles, because they are the basics for making more value of our data. So that's something Roche and following colleagues from other companies, they're pushing these principles. And I think everybody I say till now fits in these FAIR principles. Findable, like was the initial problem about finding the right data. Accessible, open standards that you can read the data. Interoperable is like a data file generating instrument. We can read in another software, or you can write your own, or for example, machine learning method and read this data. And reusable is, again, to make more use of this data, not be disposable data that you generate, answer question, and after archive, but to use for machine learning methods, for deep understanding, for data analysis. So we can use, or even for in the future, when the drug discovery process go further, sometimes have to revisit the molecule. So can we use the same analysis that we did before? So the FAIR principles are basic. Like I say, is the very ground for anything we need to build on the data.
It's sort of it's like a data manifesto in a way.
It's a data manifesto. That's a good point. Yes, it's a data manifesto. That how the data must be too.
Many industries are very proud of their innovations and the creations that they make. Pharmaceutical industries, obviously, as you mentioned, is rather it takes its time. Right, with data, and obviously it has an interest in keeping its intellectual property as close to the chest as possible. But eventually, it has to act and it has to free the data. It will have to. It'll face that choice. What do you think will be that pivotal moment that will happen?
I think 2 points here. Pharma companies is lower, but I think at least I have where I'm working that we have a really motivated to bring new solutions in this space, the automation space, FAIR space, data space. I think the managers realize that this is important and we work together. In pharma, I don't see we sharing our data, lab data with other pharma companies. This, I'll be honest, this will be really complicated, but what we can share and we do, and I think also get momentum, is this pre-competitive agreements. That means sharing knowledge, sharing experience, sharing, working together in the open standards. So everything that's go before to the drug development, we can work together. After, sure, we are not going to share unless there's another agreement outside the scope of automation, but another agreement. But everything before, we can work together. And I think that has these are quite complicated topics. And again, when you are, it's not the best word, but when you're confronting the vendors, if we as industry go together or many different voices go to the vendors and ask, we need this, you'll be much stronger than just one lab here, one lab there. So when you have the entire industry push and say, we want to free your data, you want to be able to do analysis, or you want to not worry how you open the data in 5-10 years, I think when you work together is much better. So that's, I think, is something, it's happening. That's, for example, Pistoia Alliance is a good way people are working. It's complicated, again, there's different actors, sometimes a bit slow, but it's a good example. Also, the animal allotrope formats, they are open for feedbacks. We also have the sealer format for instruments. So we have a lot of group of people working is this problem. And I think what we have to do is to work together for them. So and after this, I think like in 5 years, we can see a connected labs, fully connected labs. That's how I expect.
Felipe Albrecht, a senior scientist at Roche, discussing data liberalization. Here on Lab Insider. Thank you very much, Felipe.